I got a pretty important phone call recently. The President of the United States called me up. I was pretty surprised. He said, we've received news of a grave threat. Unless you re-implement Ruby's hash, alien terrorists will blow up SeaWorld. Blow up SeaWorld. I think he might have said some other stuff, but honestly, I was already typing. Okay, so what is a hash? Everybody knows this, I think, but some languages call it a map or a dictionary, but it's basically just a way to associate keys and values. I can say, hey, the key of appetizer has the value of fruit salad. I can ask for appetizer, and it'll give me fruit salad back. So this is our basic goal. We want to make our own class that behaves the same way. Easy peasy, right? We can do this. So here's what I'm thinking. We've got some tuples, little pairs of key and value, and whenever someone asks for a key, they say, I want cat. Then I'll just go rummaging through these tuples until I find the one I want, and I'll say, oh, this is cat. The value is gato. And if someone wants to write, then I'll go rummaging through them until I find the right one, and I'll update the value. If I don't have it, I'll insert a new tuple, and we'll be good. So I know that Ruby supports lovely syntactic sugar, like the bracket bracket and bracket bracket equals method, so that everything looks just like a hash, and I can implement it like this, which I have, and it works very nice. So I insert the key hokey with the value pokey, and I get it back out, and everything is good. So I attached that to an email, sent it off to the president. I was feeling very fine, and everything was great. Thank you all for attending my talk. Okay, actually, I'm kidding. That wasn't it. So I got a call back from the president, and he said, what kind of hash is this? A hash is supposed to have O of 1 lookup time, and this thing has O of N. I said, I'm having some trouble hearing you, Mr. President. I think I might have a bad... I'll call it... What does that mean? Why does the president know more computer science than I do? So if these words are scary to you and you don't know what they mean, you're in good company. I was in the same boat, too. And I'm going to walk you through what Big O notation is about and why it's important to the problem that we have here. So Big O notation, for beginners, it's basically just a way of talking about how an algorithm grows. It's talking about rates of growth. So as we throw more and more inputs at an algorithm, how does it scale up the amount of work that it has to do in order to solve that problem? And when you look at a graph of this, along the x-axis we have how much inputs do we have to our algorithm, and on the y-axis we have how much work does the algorithm have to do. And you can just ask one question if you want to know what Big O category something is in. How is it shaped? We don't care about angle, and we don't care about location on the graph. We only care about shape. I'm going to give you some really simple examples to kind of help you understand what I'm talking about. So suppose that I'm running this conference, and I really want everyone to feel welcome at the conference. I could do this in several ways. So my first idea is, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to walk around and shake everybody's hand. Hey, how you doing? Welcome to the conference. Nice to have you here, right? If I do that, then that's going to scale linearly, meaning if there's 10 people, I've got 10 hands to shake. If there's 100 people, I've got 100 hands to shake. So the line is going to look something like this. Well, suppose that I decide, you know, that's really not good enough. I want to be more friendly than that. When I talk to somebody, I want to find out where they live. I want to know what their hobbies are. I'm going to spend a little more time with each person. Well, that's great. That's going to make people feel good. But it's going to take longer. So the slope is going to look like this, right? I've got more work to do per person. Okay, imagine another scenario. Suppose that I shake hands at the normal rate, but because I'm kind of nervous, before I do that, I kind of have to get backstage and go, okay, I can shake hands. I can talk to people. It's going to be okay. All right, here we go. And I go out and start shaking hands. That graph would look something like this. So the slope is the same, but there's a bit of delay. For two people, I've already done one unit of work. Now, these differences matter in absolute terms. They all affect how much time it's going to take me to complete shaking everyone's hand. But in Big O terms, these are irrelevant. All of these things are O of N. They're linear. And the reason for that is, if you think about it, no matter which one of those strategies I choose, one more person equals one more handshake. That's what causes the line to be straight and have that same slope. So if there's 10 people and I get one more person, I've got one additional handshake. If we have 100 people and I get one more person, one more handshake. It works the same way no matter how many people are already at the conference. Now, in contrast, suppose that I say, I don't just want to greet people. I want everyone to know everybody else. So instead of shaking hands, I'm going to do introductions. I'm going to walk around and I'm going to say, Carla, this is Robert. Robert, this is Carla. Okay. Carla, this is Joe. Joe, this is Carla. I'm going to do this with everyone. Everyone's going to get to meet. Well, that's lovely, but that's O of N squared. Because if you think about it, if there's 10 people, I have somewhere in the neighborhood of 100 introductions to make. And if there's 100 people, I have somewhere in the neighborhood of 10,000 introductions to make. And this line doesn't go straight, it curves up, because the further along we are, the harder this gets. So when we have 10 people and if another person shows up, I've got 10 people to introduce them to. When we have 100 people and somebody shows up, I've got 100 people to introduce them to. So this is O of N squared. Okay, one more scenario. Suppose that I say, a conference this size, I don't have time for this. What I'm going to do instead is I'm just going to go up on stage and say, hey, everybody, how you doing? Welcome to the conference. This would be O of 1, okay? This is constant time. It doesn't matter how many of you there are, and this is kind of nice. You notice N is the number of inputs we have, in this case, the number of people. In O of 1, N does not appear. Totally irrelevant. If there's 10 of you, hi, glad to have you here, I'm done. If there's a million of you, hi, might need a better microphone system, but I'm done. And also, if I take longer and give a longer introduction, that doesn't matter either. It's still constant time. This is the holy grail of scalability. If you can get an algorithm that performs like this, it's beautiful because you can throw as many inputs as you want at it, and you'll never get to a point where you are having trouble executing anymore. Now, at some level, orders of growth, scalability is about feasibility, because if it takes a certain amount of work, it can get to a point where you can't actually execute and finish solving the problem anymore. So these are different orders of growth that we've talked about. There are many others. One of them, there's a famous problem in computer science. It's called the traveling salesman problem. The traveling salesman problem is basically this. Suppose I want to start out at my home city, and I want to visit some number of other cities, and visit each one once and come home. And I want to take the best path I possibly can. I don't want to go flying halfway across the country every time. I want to hop little paths from city to city. Well, how do we calculate the best path to do that? If we use the brute force method, what we would do is we would say, I'm going to calculate every possible path through all of these cities, and then I'm going to sort them, and then I'll take the best one. Well, doing it that way is O of N factorial, meaning if there's 3 cities, it's going to take me 3 times 2 times 1 steps. If there's 4 cities, 4 times 3 times 2 times 1 steps, etc. So that grows really fast, and it's kind of hard to wrap your mind around how fast that grows. I'm going to put somebody on the spot. So you there. If I'm able to do this for 5 cities in about a tenth of a second, how long do you think 22 cities would take? 22 cities. 5 cities is a tenth of a second. 22 cities, how long do you think? Just whatever. An hour. Okay. This is really, I would have guessed, who knows what I would have guessed, right? This is hard to guess. It would take 35 billion years. It is crazy, okay? And this shows you that you need to know if you're in this category, right? Because you might work for a travel search site, and somebody says, let's offer this trip planning feature. Yeah, that sounds great. We can offer that for 4 cities. We can offer that for 5 cities, but we can't offer it for 10 cities, because they will have taken their trip and come home, and we'll still be thinking about it. And if we try to offer it for 22 cities, our server farm will melt, and civilization will collapse, and the sun will burn out, and we still won't know what the best route is. So this is not a solvable problem in practical terms. Yeah, sure, it can be done, but we don't have time. So it's important to know what category your algorithm is in. And essentially, are you going to bog down, and is it going to become hard to solve your problem? So what's our problem with this hash? I said, you ask me for a key, I'm going to go rummaging through my tuples and find the one I want. Well, the problem is, the bigger that haystack gets, the longer it takes me to find the needle, right? If you've got a hash with a million items in it and you want to look something up, it's going to take me a while. Now, if I'm reading, on average, I'm going to have to walk through about half of those before I find the one I want. But to make that distinction between I have to go halfway through or I have to go all the way through, kind of irrelevant, because that slope, that's, oh, it's this and not this. We don't care about that. That's not a big O concern. It's linear. The more there are, the longer it takes. So we don't want this. This isn't how hashes really work, and this isn't how our hash should work. And by the way, I've built this class, and I've done some measurement on it, and our analysis of what's going on as we walk through these keys is borne out by this chart. So just kind of help you understand, on the left side, I've got a hash with 150 keys in it. On the right side, I've got one with about 14,500 keys. And all I'm doing is doing some writes, measuring how long that took, doing some reads, measuring how long that took, et cetera. You can see the reads take less time, because on average, we walk halfway through. That's the yellow line. Then the writes. On the writes, I'm always inserting, so I'm always going to the end. But basically, it grows linearly, just as we suspected. So how can we do this in a different way? What can we use that's O of 1? Well, something that we know that's O of 1 is array lookup by index. So if I'm going to look up the 328th item in an array versus the fifth item, well, it takes the same amount of time to do that. Well, why does that work? Well, because of RAM. So RAM has this wonderful property that's unlike a spinning disk. If you're working with a spinning disk and you're trying to get some data, you're reading from this spot and you want data from a different spot, if it's close by, you can get to it quickly. But if it's on the other side of the platter, you have to spin it around and move the read head, and it's going to take a while. But RAM is random access memory. I can get any random value from anywhere in RAM just as fast as any other random value. And Ruby can figure out where it needs to look, because if it knows that I'm looking for index 5, well, it knows that the array starts here in RAM, and it knows that every slot takes up the width of one pointer in memory, and it knows how many slots down I'm going, so it goes, you're going right here. This address in RAM is what you want. Ask for it from the computer and gets it back. So we need to make a new plan. We need to implement our hash as a real hash using a hash table, the data structure. And this is basically how it's going to work. We're going to have two parts. We're going to have a digest function. Now, these are sometimes called hash functions, but I find that gets a little confusing. You got a hash function inside of a hash data structure making a hash table, and it's kind of a little confusing. So Ruby actually does the nice thing of calling these digests to clarify, just to kind of keep them separate. And a digest is a one-way function. You put something in, you can transform it to another value reliably. It always works the same way for the same input, but you can't go backwards. You can't take the output and get back to the input. So it's a one-way function. And that's a great name, because just like digestion, digestion is one way. You can't take poop and turn it into pizza, right? You're done. At least not the same pizza. So we have a key of appetizer. We want a function that can give us a number, because we need a number to be able to do array lookup by index. And that's the other piece of our puzzle. We need a sparse array. So if I see that the key of appetizer needs to go in slot 2, well, obviously, slots 0 and 1 need to exist in order for me to be able to put something in slot 2. So I'm going to get the value of 2 for that key, and then I'm going to walk into my sparse, or I'm going to look into my sparse array directly and say, this goes in slot 2. So we're going to implement it like this. We'll be able to instantly go to the place where we want, instantly get out the value, no rummaging around, and it's going to scale beautifully. Thank you very much for listening to my presentation. No, I'm sorry. I'm still messing with you. Okay. There are problems with this approach. There's a problem with collisions, first off. So we can't guarantee that when we hash a particular key that we're going to come up with a unique value. In fact, we probably won't. We'll have some collisions. So we've stored a value of fruit salad for appetizer, and along comes someone and tries to store a value of for mammal. Oh no, that goes in slot 2. What do we do? Well, the solution to this problem is to go back to our old solution of a tuple map. In that slot, when we get to slot 2, we'll say, well, we got several things here. Rummage around through them, find the one we want. Obviously, if there's too many things in this location, in this bucket, we're going to be right back where we started. But put that problem aside, we'll come back to it. The second problem that we have is waste. So I said, if we have a sparse array, we want to put something in slot 2, we need slot 0 and 1 to exist, but we don't have anything to put there. Those are just nils. That's wasteful, right? We're just wasting memory with all these nils. What's the solution to that problem? Get over it, basically. We can do some things about it, but the hashes are a trade-off. This is the key thing to see. What we're doing when we build a hash is we're trading memory for speed. We're saying, I'm willing to waste some of this memory and have all these blank spaces lying around just so that I have the guarantee that slot 2 is there for me and I can get there quickly. Trading memory for speed. So is there a grand solution? Is there some way that we can minimize these issues, minimize collisions? Because the more collisions we have, the more things we have in a bucket, the slower we're going to be. But we also want to minimize the amount of memory that we waste, because who likes wasting memory, right? Well, here's our solution. We're going to grow as needed. We're going to start out with a few buckets, and we'll start out with a few blanks in memory, and we'll grow as we need to. What does it mean to grow as needed? You could define this in a lot of different ways. I'm using a really simple definition. I'm just going to say, if there's 10 keys in a bucket, too many. We're gonna grow. What does it mean to grow? Well, the basic idea is that we want to get more buckets, and we want to spread things out. It doesn't help to have a bunch more buckets if everything is still piled up the way it used to be. So we want to have some way of spreading them out so that when we're done, most buckets don't have much in them. So one key thing to see is that every key is going to need to have a new bucket calculated for it. We've got to go back through all of our keys when we do this and figure out where they go now. So here's our basic strategy for our hash. We're going to start out with X number of buckets, whatever. We're going to compute a raw digest value for whatever key we've got. I'm going to come back to how we do that. And then we're going to say, what bucket number does it go in? We're going to go take that number, modulo the number of buckets, and that's the bucket it goes in. I think everyone knows what modulo means, but I just want to make sure we're all on the same page. It's basically just divide and take the remainder. So any number modulo 3 is going to come out with one of three values. So we can have a guarantee that we're always going to know which bucket it goes in. Now, when we grow, we're going to be growing from some number of buckets to some other number of buckets. And like I said, the whole point is for us to be able to spread things out. Imagine if we grew from size 3 to size 6. A lot of things that divide evenly by 3 also divide evenly by 6. So we would end up with a lot of things in the same buckets. That wouldn't be so great. But you can see, if we grow from 3 to 7, most things mod 3 versus mod 7 are different values. So that would be a good way to grow. Well, how can we generalize that? How can we know if I'm at a particular size, what size should I move to? Well, I'm not going to go into all the gory details, but a basic strategy that works well is double the number of buckets, then go to the next prime number. Using prime numbers means that we rarely end up with things that divide the same way, and we generally spread things out differently. So if you're at size 199, we'll go to size 401. From 401, we'll go to 809, et cetera. All right, I just glossed over this before. Where do we get a raw digest value? Somebody's giving us a key. We want to come up with a number that we can then modulo and so forth. Well, this is kind of hard. I spent some time thinking about this, and my first thought was, I can take a string key, and I can turn that to Unicode code points, and those are numbers, and then, that's what I'll use. That'll be the number I'll do modulo the number of buckets, et cetera. But we don't just have to support string keys. In Ruby, anything can be a key. A string can be a key, an array can be a key, some hat object can be a key, so I can't just depend on it being a string. Well, what else do we have? Everything's an object in Ruby, right? And everything has an object ID, and that is a number. Well, what if we use that? Not going to work. Because every object that's like these two strings, A and A, those are different objects, and they have different object IDs, but we don't want to care about that with hashes. We don't want to have to hang on to the same string to be able to use it to get the value out that we set. We want to be able to use a string that looks like the one we set it with, and that should be good enough. We want same value keys, quote unquote, to be interchangeable. But that's a really fuzzy concept. I mean, suppose you use a hat object as a key. How do I know if this hat is equal to that hat? What do I use? Size? Color? I don't know. How would I know if they're equal? It's a subjective sort of idea. Ruby's solution to this is to ask the object. The object is responsible for telling you what its raw digest value is, and that's with the .hash method. Every object in Ruby has this method. And it's always going to give you a number, and the contract that it has to uphold is that if two objects are .eql question mark, if they're equal in that sense, then they must provide the same hash value. If you want to use custom objects like your own hat class as keys, that's fine. You can say hats are equal if they're the same size, as long as two hats of the same size produce the same .hash value. So, to review, here's what we've got so far. We're going to, for any key someone gives us, we're going to turn that into a number using the .hash method. Now we've got a number, we can do modulo the number of buckets we have. We know what bucket to put it in. As the buckets fill up, we're going to say it's time to grow. We'll grow in order to spread things out. Spreading things out helps us stay fast so we don't have to go rummaging through too many things in a given bucket. But it also means we're using more memory. So that's our trade-off. Well, we've done all of this work. in the hopes that we get O of 1 performance. And for a hash, that means I don't care how much stuff is in that hash. I want to be able to look something up in the same amount of time as I could when there was only 10 things in it. So if we've done this right, I should be able to show you a graph that shows you a flat line for reads and writes. As the hash gets larger and larger, it stays flat. Did we do it? Are you guys ready to see the graph? Can you please give me a hand for the graph? Woo! Yeah! Ah! Whoa. Okay. We're okay. So let's just take it one thing at a time. First thing I want you to notice, see those nice flat lines? So you can see way over on the left side, as I'm doing reads with my very small hash with only 100,000 items, it takes a certain amount of time, and way over here when I've got 9.7 million items, it's about the same. So that's perfect, right? That's really nice. The yellow line looks beautiful. The green line is our write, and pretty much looks nice, right? We've got way over on the left side, taking a certain amount of time, taking about the same amount of time way over here on the right side, and we've got a lot of keys in it. So that's pretty good. We just have some kind of spiky issues there in the middle. So what's that about? Well, those spikes happen when we redistribute, when we go back through and figure out which buckets do our keys go in now. We've had to grow, and we've had to go back through every key and figure out where it goes. Okay, well, how are we doing, though? How does this stack up to the native Ruby hash? Does the Ruby hash have this problem? Well, in fact, yes, it does. As the Ruby hash grows, it has these spikes. There are times when it has to redistribute its keys into its new buckets. Now you can see the Ruby hash is about 0.2 seconds up there at 5-ish million keys, so it's a pretty fast thing. And I'm wondering, how do we stack up to that? How big are our spikes? Oh! Yikes! Okay, so don't use my hash in production. This is pretty bad. But have we failed? Is this a sign of our hash being incorrect? Well, notice this, that both of these have linearly increasing spikes. The slope on the Ruby hash is much lower, but they both are basically doing the same thing. And we don't care about slope in big O terms, right? So they both have linearly increasing spikes because whenever you have to reorganize and redistribute, you have to walk back through every single key. That's just the way it works. Okay, so did we get O of 1 performance or not? Well, let's think through this. When I read a key, I'm always going to know right which bucket to go to, and that bucket is never going to have more than 10 items in it, because I'm going to resize if it does. So I know I won't have to do more than 10 steps at that point. So we can call that part, the reads, O of 1. And writes are the same way. As long as I don't happen to be the unlucky write that causes a redistribution, I'm going to be able to go right to the place I want and update it, and that'll be great. So what about those writes, those redistribution points? Well, the growth has to take n steps because we have to walk through every single key and figure out where it goes. But as that process gets slower, it also gets less frequent. Remember, we double the number of buckets and go to the next prime. So what's actually happening, if you imagine that graph, the mountains get higher and higher and higher, but they also get further and further apart. So imagine you take each mountain and squish it down into its valley. If you do that, you find that you get a flat field. So another way of thinking of this is to say that every write incurs a certain amount of debt. When you do a write, you know sometime in the future you're going to have to redistribute everything. Maybe not yet, but eventually. So every write incurs a certain amount of debt, and some unlucky write pays them off. When we do this, we're doing what they call amortized analysis. We're saying, spread out over the life of this thing, what happens? And each one has the same penalty. It's O of 1. It stays the same across the board. So we succeeded. Woo! This calls for celebratory clip art. I was feeling pretty good about this. I attached it to an email. I sent it off to the president. And I kicked back to relax and think over some other lovely ideas, such as, could we make this faster? Well, we could implement it in C. That's what Ruby does. We could maybe redigest concurrently using some kind of fancy algorithm or something. We could trade off more memory at a time. But why bother, right? The Ruby native hash is great. This is really a learning exercise. More interestingly, what can we learn from this process? Well, one thing we learned is that hashes are amazing. Hashes are an O of one multi-tool you can use in all kinds of situations. They just, you can keep using them and they're going to scale beautifully. Another thing is that we have other things that work like hashes, distributed hash tables, like the React database and anything based on DynamoDB, Cassandra. Those have the same trade-offs. Essentially, what they're doing is they're using a digest to figure out where to put your key in some structure of servers of the database. So think about what happens when you run out of space and you have to grow. Do you want to grow by one server and spend all that penalty of rehashing every key? Or do you want to double the number of servers? It makes more sense to double. This has a lot of implications for other things you might do. Well, I was mulling over all of these things and stroking my beard and smoking my bubble pipe when I got another phone call. The president called me back. He said, "Dude, where's your hash?" I said, "What are you talking about? I sent you that email 3 hours ago." He said, I never got an email from you. I went and looked in my email, and it was sitting in my outbox. I said, "I'm sorry, Mr. President, I'll send it right away." And he said, "It's too late. Alien terrorists blew up SeaWorld." Blew up SeaWorld. No! It was all a dream. Thank you very much for listening to my talk.